Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Woodrow Wilson Center. It's a pleasure to have you here, and it's a great pleasure to have Secretary Ildefonso Guajardo here at the Wilson Center with us. He will be introduced more formally by Duncan Wood in a minute, the director of the Mexico Institute. But let me say that I've had the pleasure of knowing Secretary Guajardo for many years. He's been one of Mexico's great public servants in his home state of Nuevo León, at a national level in Mexico, and in the U.S.-Mexico relationship and on a global stage. Last time he spoke here, he's been here a number of times. We've had the great pleasure of his company. But I remember a conversation we had when he was a congressman and was very involved in competitiveness issues, a set of issues he has followed throughout his career, and was instrumental in getting through Mexico's first class action law, as well as a number of other measures that have increased Mexico's competitiveness. And so a great pleasure to have him here now as Secretary of the Economy. We are in the middle of great debates on trade in this country right now and our economic future. Without entering into that controversial subject, let me say that no matter, we reasonable people can disagree, and these things are disagreed on in Mexico, in the United States, and around the world, but there is no question that we have a deeply integrated economy with that of Mexico. We have a truly integrated, complex economy. There's over $1 billion a day that flows in trade, that flows across our common border. Mexico is close behind Canada and China as our three major trading partners, and it's the second destination for our exports. Many of these things are not conventional trade. In fact, we manufacture things together. It'd be very hard to get I don't know how you all got here today, but whether you got in a train, a car, or a plane, doubtful, but perhaps, you almost certainly got into a vehicle that was manufactured jointly between Mexico and the United States. Increasingly within North America, we have a shared production platform. As Chris Wilson has shown, colleague here at the Wilson Center, about 40% of Mexico's exports to the United States is U.S. content, and that's because we are manufacturing things together. This is a unique trading relationship in that sense. At the beginning, we talked about large companies that were part of this trading relationship, but as the Secretary could tell us, increasingly small and medium enterprises are involved in this, and they're involved in the value chains that are part of this export relationship and part of this joint production platform. We've also seen immense investment, not only from the United States and Mexico, but increasingly from Mexico and the United States. If anyone had this morning their milk, they had some bakery products, or they simply sat in a house that was made with concrete, there are very good chances that there are inputs from Mexican companies in their morning routine. Mexican companies are vital, not only are U.S. companies vital in Mexico, but Mexican companies are vital in ways that we don't always know. We are fortunate to have Mexico, with whom we share values and share demographics, as our neighbor, and we have great challenges on a global level as well. And so without further ado, let me turn it over to Dr. Duncan Wood, director of the Mexico Institute, and also give you greetings on behalf of Jane Harmon, president of the Wilson Center, and her welcome to Secretary Guajardo.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Seeley. Wonderful introduction for us here today. Mr. Secretary, welcome to the Wilson Center. It is terrific to have you up here on this stage again. It is a wonderful opportunity for us to engage in conversation and dialogue with you. I really appreciate you taking the time to do this, and I would like to emphasize how important it is that we have these conversations at this point in time. Regardless of politics, it's just important to reaffirm, to double down on the importance of the bilateral relationship with Mexico. The way, ladies and gentlemen, that we're going to set things up here today is that I will pose a few questions to Secretary Guajardo, and then we would like to maximize the time that you have to engage in conversation with the Secretary. And so we are going to try to leave at least 25 minutes for Q&A with the audience. And so without any further ado, let me just launch in, if I may.
Yes.
Thank you. A couple of weeks ago, I was very fortunate to be invited to a stakeholder meeting around the high-level economic dialogue. And it was a terrific opportunity to engage in conversation with the with yourself, with Secretary Pritzker, with a number of other representatives from both governments about the current status of the bilateral economic relationship, and also where we as stakeholders believe the priorities should be in the future. One thing that I noticed when I was talking about this with colleagues back here in Washington is that there is a lack of understanding about what the high-level economic dialogue actually is, what it is supposed to do. And it seems to me that this is one of the really, truly significant achievements of this administration, that we've managed to get this institutionalization of that conversation. And we can have a conversation later on about whether it should be more institutionalized. But could you just take a few minutes right now to explain to the audience here, what is the HLED? Why is it important? What is the structure of it? And what is the role for it going forward? Because I think that's a very, very important element. It's basic, but I'm a firm believer that we all need to be speaking the same language and to understand basic terminology.
Well, basically, what I can say, first of all, thank you for the invitation, Duncan. Andrew, thanks for opening always a space here at the Wilson Center for Mexican issues and the U.S.-Mexico relationship. But the easiest way in which I can describe the high-level economic dialogue is this recognition by President Obama and President Peña that the integration that we have created in North America is so important because what we ambitioned 20 years ago when we did NAFTA was to create a free trade zone. But 20 years later, you realize that we went really further than that. And what we have today is an area where we integrate things together, just like Andrew was saying. We build cars together, we build planes together, medical devices. And the point is, if you are putting together production, you need to facilitate and to reduce transaction cost on the border. So how do you want to be efficient putting things together if you have borders that do not respond to the new needs of the 21st century? So you have to, for the first time, get teams on both sides of the aisle of the government to plan for infrastructure. If Mexico is going to have a new facility, that facility has to be connected on the other side. And we have to make sure that we are going to build infrastructure where this required and where it will do the most good in this process of integration. So the high-level economic dialogue has different areas of collaboration. One of them is let's work for the future on border crossing, having the best technology, the best possibility of reducing time of waiting for trucks going across the border. The second item has to do with the fact that we have to make sure in this dialogue that what we require from industries, norms, standards, regulations, have to be homologized or standardized between the three countries. It does not make sense if you, our steel industry, are producing things together, that the requirements that we ask from them in Mexico are different from the ones that you ask for them in the U.S. So we have to make sure that we can accept the same rules and regulations for all industries. That implies, obviously, cost for the industry, and that will help them to really standardize how they meet these requirements. The other big challenge that we have to accomplish in this process is we all the new methods for organizing clusters, production clusters. You have it in the U.S., we have it in Mexico. But never before HLED, we had thought together in binational clusters. And those are realities. For instance, when the Toyota opened 10 years ago or more in San Antonio, it was obvious that the supply chain comes all the way down to Monterrey, Saltillo, even San Luis Potosí. So we cannot think only of clusters that are just national, they become binational. And we have to think on them in the way we are going to structure our research centers, human capital development, on how to strengthen those clusters that are binational clusters. So we did an exercise with INEGI from Mexico and Harvard University in order to really map the binational clusters all along the border. And that means, where are the universities? Where are the firms doing things integrated? Where the supply is coming from? Where are the research centers that are giving ideas for these developments? Where should we be investing money for new projects in R&D? And so that helps planning, and the planning should not be done independently from one another because we are doing things together in that regard. So it's basically better infrastructure, modern custom facilities, better regulation that can be met easily, clusterization process that are really developed jointly. And we have a new platform that is called Mosaic for R&D, which is basically very important for the future challenges. Today, as Andrew was saying, the name of the game is trade is responsible for all the problems that that society has. That's at least what politicians say everywhere, not just the U.S. But when you look at the problem, the big challenges for employment for the future are not coming from trade, are coming from the modernization of the production process, robotization, and all the items that are really doing a tremendous change in the way we produce things in the world. So this new industrial revolution 4.0 is giving us the challenge of how to respond when we have to develop new jobs for value-added in technologies of information and much more higher challenges in value-added in production process. So trade can be the solution for that. It's not the cause of the problem. We are missing the point. The challenge comes from a natural process of development of technologies that we have to face. And if we miss the point that trade is a tool to facilitate trade in services, that at the end of the day is going to make the difference in how fast we integrate and create alternatives for more or well-paid jobs for the future, then we're missing the point.
Thank you. One of the aspects of the high-level economic dialogue that to me appears to be very, very important is the fact that you have this very varied, wide agenda on economic affairs. But the high-level economic dialogue as a mechanism allows you to see the crossovers between all the different things that are being negotiated. That gives you the forum where you're able to engage in wide-ranging conversations about issues that seem to be very, very different from one another, but of course impact upon each other. The Mosaic conversation on entrepreneurship and innovation is, of course, fundamental to expanding and to deepening the benefits from trade for a broader constituency throughout the region. And that enables you to do that. Some of the conversations that have been held about education, of course, are fundamental there. So issues that would not necessarily always be treated at the same table can now have that crossover. And that leads me to the question about the stakeholder engagement, because the meeting that we had in Mexico City a couple of weeks ago was terrific in the sense that you had interested parties from both nations sitting there talking. But what was clear to me was that this is still a relatively limited group of stakeholders. How do you feel that we could best use that mechanism of engaging with stakeholders? How can we expand the group that is consulted? And should this be institutionalized in a much deeper way than it is right now?
I do believe that there are two levels of involvement in this dialogue from the private sector. I think that what you are putting for discussion is the possibility of really broadening, really making it bigger for the participation of groups that have to be included in terms of really understanding the benefits of trade, of integration. But there has to be a group of CEOs at the same time that leave the border every day, that suffer the bureaucracy around international trade. For us, that the best players are involved is because, or the most important players are involved, is because they are ready to tell us, you have a problem in this border, the waiting time for trucks is too long, the problem is because this is not working, the facility, the technology, or telling us the kind of specific things we have to change in policy to make things happen. So on one side, you do need a very technical group of business that had been working through the border all the time and with issues between the U.S. and Mexico that can come to us and tell us we need public policy design in this, and that. And then I agree with you. At the same time, you need a bigger group that has the ability to communicate what this means for society and for opportunities. But that is to spread the word, to really convince society of the benefits of integration and trade in a kind of a two-level participation. But you do need a very technical, small private sector group telling governments how to facilitate things in this interaction.
Thank you. Now, I mentioned the term institutionalization a couple of times, and that was one of the repeated calls at the stakeholder meeting was, how do we make sure that the high-level economic dialogue keeps going, regardless of changes in administration, on both sides of the border, to be fair? Because there's a tendency, of course, in all countries to say, well, that was the previous administration's toy, so we're going to create a new one. How do we keep it going? Because there have been so many concrete benefits from this conversation. What ideas are the two governments discussing right now about how we can make this last?
Well, I do believe that for things to really continue and get institutionalized in the dialogue, there has to be a very, very strong request by the private sector. I do believe that on the U.S. side, the leading business group that is associated with this is the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. On the Mexican side is el Consejo Coordinador Empresarial. And both of them need to send very clear letters to leaders before the meeting of June 29 to request an institutionalization of this process. How to make sure that the high-level economic dialogue is going to continue after the administrations involved change. And that can happen by the persistence of the private sector. Now, internally in the government, we can leave things set, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Mexico, State Department in the US, and try to continue the same process regardless of who comes next in the executive branch. But the idea is to get the private sector to monitor that this process will go on with the same strength we have been able to put it together today.
Great. Before the event began, I detected a few Canadian accents in the audience. It's always difficult to tell them because they look just like Americans, but you know that underneath they're slightly different. Slightly. Let's expand the conversation to North America from just the bilateral relationship for a second. We have a North American Leaders Summit coming up in June. Mm-hmm. Clearly, the question of North American competitiveness will be central to those conversations. I've heard you comment that the recent political changes in Canada open up a whole new world, I won't start singing, but a new world of possible interactions now that were not possible before. What do you think that a more ambitious North American agenda looks like? And what are the issues? And this is a crucial thing. I was yesterday in Phoenix, Arizona, discussing the future of North America with folks at ASU, from the Anahuac University and from the University of Calgary. And the question that kept coming up, as it has done for years and years, is what are the issues that are best dealt with trilaterally versus those that are best dealt with bilaterally?
Well, definitely, let's admit that for the last 10 years before the new Prime Minister of Canada came to office, Canadian governments had been extremely hesitant to keep on talking trilaterally. For them, bilateralism was the only way to really carry their policy goals in Canada. So we really missed the ship for about 10 years in continuing talking about the North America. I think that we're in good shape today. The Prime Minister of Canada has made a commitment to solve some of the basic elements that were really disturbing the relationship with Mexico. The visa issue was a big issue that there is a commitment to take care of, and that is going to change drastically the way we discuss things. I do believe that trilateral discussions had to do with the competitiveness of North America, how we can recuperate or reposition North America in the world in terms of competitiveness. When we did NAFTA 1994, U.S., Canada, and Mexico were responsible for 19% of exports in the world. Today, when you add the exports of the three countries in relative terms, we are responsible for only 12% of exports in the world. The question is, who got the 6% or 7% that we lost? Obviously, the answer is China and Asia. So we need to go back into this design of trying to compete and trying to recover what we lost in the last two decades and make North America more competitive. When I listen to some of the candidates in the U.S. about, I mean, it's not only one maybe goes to extremes, but they said, let's renounce NAFTA or or we are going to impose tariffs to cars being made in Mexico or auto parts coming from Mexico. The only thing you are doing with that is making American products more expensive. And the only thing you are doing with that is reducing the capacity of the U.S. to compete with Europe and Asia in the auto industry. So at the end of the day, you are going to just going to lose American jobs. So in that regard, I think that it's clear that the work Canada, Mexico, and the U.S. have to do is how we integrate our energy capacities in order to have one of the most competitive regions in the world. Today, we are blessed with the cheapest gas in the world. Gas is the basic element for manufacturing. I mean, that by itself is a competitive advantage that nobody else has in the world. So we have to align our energy strategies. We have to really work deeply in how we are going to integrate our production process and facilitate and reduce transaction costs in this process. And we have to really play our trade policy aligned with a very communist strategy. If Canada has just finished negotiating a trade agreement with Europe, the U.S. is in the middle of doing the one, and I'm going to announce next month that I'm going to modernize the European-Mexican agreement, it has to make sense that we really talk to each other and work toward convergence of these three agreements, because it's trade between North America and the European Union. So makes a lot of sense to really align an agenda of trade policy between Canada, Mexico, and the U.S. I'll give you a very good example. Today, we're suffering from the invasion of steel oversupply by China and Asia. Europe, Canada, Mexico, the U.S., we are having a lot of pressures for this overcapacity. And we're trying to react to protect our industrial plants against unfair competition. It makes the full sense that we get together, and we're going to get together in Brussels, to try to give a common response to the Chinese. Either you reduce your production and stop dumping on us the steel product that you cannot sell in China, or we are going to really react violently, trade speaking. I'm saying with tariffs and anti-dumping measures that we have been doing it in Mexico, but we have to align our strategies to avoid losing jobs and plants due to unfair competition. So it is a must that we have to align our strategies together.
Excellent. Well, you've raised the image of Asia, competition from Asia, and of course that naturally leads us to the conversation about TPP as a long-term strategy for engaging with Asia, for a long-term strategy in terms of taking advantage of the markets that are growing out there. We've had a problem, I think, it's fair to say, over the past couple of years about coordinating those positions. You talked about Europe. We need to talk about some of the experience of TPP. There was a very difficult moment in the negotiations over the TPP with regards to the automobile sector. And this sort of really focused attention on the need for the three governments to work together to solve these problems. Now, let me ask you, what does this really tell us about shared interests in the region? And looking a bit further ahead, when, if TPP is ratified, and I know that you're optimistic about the ratification process in both Mexico and the United States, but how is Mexico's competitiveness going to be affected by TPP? When we look back over the history of Mexican trade and competitiveness, each time that a challenge has been put in front of the Mexican private sector, the Mexican private sector has reacted by saying, can you protect us for a little bit? We will adjust eventually. And eventually they have. But it's often been the case that they've waited until the last minute to actually make those competitiveness adjustments. Are you confident that the Mexican economy is ready to face the competition that a TPP really offers them?
Definitely. The answer is yes. And let me tell you that when you look at the Mexican trade policy, it is very, very easily understood when you look at, we started opening the Mexican economy with a great decision more than 20 years ago, NAFTA. NAFTA came into force in 94. That helped a lot to change the mentality of the Mexican business community, because before NAFTA, they were scared for competition. Give you examples. The Mexican beer makers, Cuauhtémoc, Carta Blanca, and Modelo, Corona, they say, no, leave us out. We think that all the American brands are going to be killing the Mexican market, and we don't want to compete. Obviously, we force them to compete, and we put them into the process of opening the beer industry. 20 years later, Mexico is the number one exporter of beers in the world. 20 years later, in the last 4 months, we have bring to Mexico more than $10 billion of investment in beer factories, one in Coahuila, one in Mexicali, one in Mérida, Yucatán, one in Chihuahua. I mean, they are producing beers, bottles, the whole full integrated process. More than $10 billion of investment in less than 9 months. And so the same happened with other sectors, meat producers. Today, now they are on the offensive. 20 years ago, they were on the defensive. And they now learn how to compete. I went with the president yesterday. No, the day before yesterday. It was on Tuesday, on Wednesday, for the opening of a new plant to produce meat products in the northern part of Mexico, fully integrated from the beginning of the process. There was an investment of $600 million. They are going to produce 240,000 tons of meat, yearly. This is a firm that now is exporting to more than 20 countries in the world. So there is a new mentality in the Mexican business community that can definitely be a strong force for action. Many of those companies have become global thanks to the opening of the Mexican economy. You have in the U.S. 6,500 establishments for more than 40 global Mexican companies in the U.S., creating more than 120,000 jobs in the U.S. We're talking about Bimbo, Mexichem, Cemex, name it. They are all over the place. So that has helped the Mexican business community to become very confident of their abilities to compete worldwide and in Mexico. That being said, the next challenge was Mexico was successfully integrating to North America. We just finished our negotiation with Alianza Pacifico, understanding that there is a new part of the continent that is open for investment, that is modern Chile, Peru, Colombia, and Mexico, different from the Albos and different from Mercosur. And we are going to modernize the treaty with Europe starting April. So north, south, west, east. But we did not have a clear policy on how to associate with Asia. Even with the 11 agreements that we have with 46 countries, free trade agreements in the world, only one was from Asia, Japan, and was an agreement that did not have the deepness that was needed for the Mexican economy. So TPP is the right answer in how to engage with Asia, a continent that has been growing for rates of about 10% a year. So Mexican policy was not well designed. That will complete the position of Mexico as a strategic platform for integration. That will round up our strategy. Now, obviously, some sectors always complain. And when I start talking to some business about negotiating TPP, they say, if it's broken, why fix it? We like NAFTA. Why to move away from NAFTA? And I told them, it's not moving away from NAFTA. Is modernizing NAFTA, is taking NAFTA to the next step. 20 years later, NAFTA has to be improved. 20 years ago, we didn't have electronic trade. Now in TPP, we have a charter on electronic trade. 20 years ago, some of the most important issues in intellectual property were not really as important as they are today. And one of the most important parts, how we integrate small business into production process in order to really spread the benefits of trade. And Mexico has taken that challenge very seriously, because now with TPP, we are jumping into TPP after doing 6 very important reforms that will level the playing field for small business to take advantage of international trade. When we did NAFTA, NAFTA was great, but unfortunately, the homework, internal homework, to really make the Mexican economy internally more competitive was not fully done. We didn't reform the energy sector. We didn't make reforms in the labor framework. So all these 6 economic reforms that the president was able to pass through Congress are already start making the difference for competition. With one example, you'll understand what I'm saying. When we did NAFTA, when we did not liberalize oil and gas, the petrochemical industry could not use cheaper gas, and this is the basic element for petrochemicals. And so the gap of demand from overseas of petrochemicals widened tremendously. 66% of petrochemicals were imported. Now, in the stage of TPP, the petrochemical industry is going to have a great possibility because now we have privatized the petrochemical industry. Now it's not only Pemex the one that can be involved. And that will make a big difference, because petrochemicals are the base of all change of production, plastics, textiles. So the competitiveness of the integration are going to be great.
I promised our audience that we would allow them 25 minutes for questions. It's 9:50. I'm exactly on time. This is incredible. This is what happens when you have an Englishman on stage. Let me just please allow me to recognize Undersecretary Francisco de Rosenzweig, who's here with us as well. Thank you very much for being with us. And let me just say that I don't know if you've read the book, The Revenge of Geography, but this is a terrific treatise on why maps matter. And I'm always drawn back to that idea of Mexico's geographic position. Atlantic, Pacific, North America, Latin America, it's a very privileged geographic location. I open the floor to our audience. The hands are going up left, right, and center.
Wow.
This is extraordinary. There's a microphone right there, so let's please take that question there, and then we'll bring one over here in the front.
Hi, Gabriel Toledo from the George Washington University. In 2015, Mexico exported 82.9% of its exports to the U.S. and Canada, while only 3% to the rest of the TPP countries. How should the TPP be ratified? How would you expect these percentages to change over the next 20 years? Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, if we take three questions. Mm-hmm. Okay, right here, please.
We know who you are. And you have a strong voice.
You know I'm going to ask about TPP.
I thought you were going to ask about Trump.
There you go.
You disappoint me.
Okay, so wanted to ask you about TPP, Mr. Secretary. As you're probably aware, in the United States Congress, there's lots of demands for changes to the TPP on issues like biologics, but not by changing the agreement itself, but rather through other sorts of tools like more side letters or implementation plans. So I guess I just wanted to know, is Mexico at all open to making those types of changes on some of these issues through alternative tools, not reopening the TPP, especially if you don't do so, it means that Congress doesn't pass the TPP and it never enters into force?
Thank you. And then there's a question sort of directly, yes, behind the gentleman with the walking stick. Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. Good morning, Mr. Secretary.
How are you, my friend?
Muy bien. You spoke about modernization.
Could you introduce yourself to the audience, please?
My name is Jose Nino, former president of the United States Hispanic Chamber of Commerce, active in NAFTA. In the modernization that you spoke about today, and modernizing NAFTA and the TPP and so on, two areas that are of great interest is that of the energy sector, which you spoke a bit about, and the telecommunications sector. One, the energy sector, because even in our country, the utility companies of America are modernizing its infrastructure to the point of $1.3 billion that started 3 years ago. Likewise, Mexico is doing something similar in its electrical programs. On that question, what's going on in that arena, and how do we both collectively participate, both with small and medium-sized businesses? Because in the first round of NAFTA, most of the ones that participated were the big corporations. And second, the telecommunications side. As you said before, that wasn't part of the original NAFTA, and it exploded onto the scene. Now, with the Internet of Things coming, and both AT and Google fighting in America to wire up cities, that's going to have an effect in going down to Mexico to doing the same thing. And there lies a lot of opportunity, again, for small and medium-sized businesses to participate, whether it's in the towers, but most important, in the last mile of that program. Could you speak a little bit to both of those? Thank you,
Thank
sir.
You.
The impact of TPP on diversification, I think, is extremely important. let me give you an idea of things that have happened through the three terms of President Peña. Our relationship with China was a disaster for many years because it was just driven by grievances of subsidies in textiles, subsidies in steel manufactured products. And when you look at the trade balance between Mexico and China, about 80% of what we get from China are inputs that go in over into our exports. Just like of every peso that we export, 37 cents are coming from the U.S. We are exporting U.S. goods. So there is also a part of that integration that comes from China. And really, about 9% of the discussions and challenges come from final products that sometimes are subsidized and create a problem in the Mexican internal market. But that should not have been the way to really deal with that relationship. For many years, tequila was not allowed to be exported to China. Well, after we started a new relationship, we are now selling tequila in China. Avocados were taxed with 25% tariffs, and now that rate has been reduced to 10%. We are exporting fresh berries to China. Some of the meat products of Mexico now has been qualified for sanitary reasons now to enter into China. So the idea is how to really balance our relationship with Asia. So definitely there is a scope to diversify our exports and to really increase the trade relationship that we have with other regions in the world. But at the end of the day, given the strong integration of production that is happening in North America, the U.S. will always be our biggest trading partner. Well, with a small exception, if Mr. Trump wins the election, that may change. But so far, that's been the case. Now, in the second question that was asked by our friend from a trade journal in Washington. He always asks questions that he knows the answer, but he wants to hear it from a government official so he can write it with a name. let me tell you that we went to New Zealand to sign the agreement on February the 4th. And when you sign an agreement, it's because the negotiation has been done. And it has been done in the best interest of all parties involved, including the U.S. I believe Ambassador Froman did a great job in this negotiation process. When you have 12 countries trying to really only get to one position on very tough issues, it's not an easy task. And we were able to do it. You mentioned one specific item, which is intellectual property in the biomedicine or biochemical sector and biotechnology in medicine. And there, that was the item that lasted until 5 o'clock in the morning when we closed negotiations in Atlanta, because it was a very tough issue for some countries. It is not for Mexico. Mexico has been advancing really fast in all the regulations on the medical area, in the medical industry, in pharmaceutical industry. And we have a very modern agency for recognition of formulas. And therefore, it's not a big issue for us. The negotiation, had it ended, is a perfect balance between the extreme of giving a protection that is 12 years that was... It's not even really the case that is enforced in the U.S. It's what the law says, 12 years. But then you have to take it into account that some countries started at zero, like Chile, like Peru, like Vietnam. Mexico always thought that the right balance should be what it is today. A basic 8-year process that will please all the interests involved. Long enough to guarantee research and development, and short enough to let biosimilars come to the market in time to really take care of public health system. So I think that at the end of the day, the balance was proper. It was a good solution. And I think that once it is understood the type of commitment that is behind that agreement, everybody will work for it. So if there are explanations to be given about how it will work, probably all the countries will be willing to cooperate. But there is not space to change the basic of the negotiating package. It will make no sense, because if something is going to change, it's obvious that countries will ask for something else. And so we'll never end negotiating the agreement. The agreement has been already negotiated and is there for consultation. And I believe that if what they require is a better explanation of what is the final outcome and how it will work and the commitments of the country for the implementing bills that will be required in every country, obviously everybody is willing to cooperate to make it very clear the understanding of the agreement, but not to change the basic content of the agreement. Now, the third question was on the telecommunications by my friend from the chamber, the Hispanic Chamber of Commerce. Let me tell you that definitely those two sectors have been tremendously transformed in Mexico. Just talking about the energy sector, we have finished the first round of biddings where 30 contracts have been granted by the oil industry in Mexico. The electrical company has given the first permit for the transmission of energy by private agents in Mexico, which is going to make a revolution in terms of competing for energy prices. Already today, a year after the reform was done, we have been able to reduce industrial price of electricity by 30%. So that has a tremendous impact on competitiveness of the Mexican manufacturing sector. So the impact of that is incredible. Now, in telecommunications, I don't know if you are aware that Mexican inflation in 2015 was 2.1 or something like that. It is the lowest since we registered inflation in Mexico. And the reason how we got such a low inflation rate is because many of the results of the reforms, reduction in the price of telephone services, in the reduction in the price of electricity and some energy concepts, the increase in the acquisitive power of the population by the creation of almost 2 million jobs in 3 years, the increase in transfers in the value of transfers by Mexicans to the U.S. economy, Mexicans abroad, all that at the end of the day was a very strong impulse for internal consumption. To give you an example, the sales of retail of supermarket department stores in Mexico, of this big organization, is reporting increases of 12.5% increase of sales in Mexico when you compare February of 2016 with February of 2015. So in 1 year, there is an increase of double digits in internal consumption. Car sales in 2015, they increased by almost 20% in the internal market. So there is a tremendous impact of the results in the reforms have been representing pushing power increase in the Mexican economy that is fueling at least the 2.5% growth that we had in 2015. Not that tremendous big growth, but at least the best that you can see in Latin America at this point in time. And you made a comment on the small business at the end of your comment. The fact that TPP is done after the reforms is going to make a big difference between NAFTA and TPP. NAFTA was done, some reforms were accomplished, but very important reforms were left untouched. Energy, financial sector, labor, education, and all those had an impact in the cost of doing business for a small business in Mexico. To give you an example, if you wanted to be a supplier of a car maker, and you have a competitor in Texas after NAFTA, yes, there is an opportunity, but you have to pay more for financing because international interest rate was lower than in Mexico. You have to pay more for energy. You did have to pay more for energy. You did have to pay more for telecommunication items that were essential for the modernization of manufacturing. And so you were competing with your neighbor in a very disadvantaged way. Your neighbor could be in Germany or could be in Japan or could be in the United States. Now, with TPP, the reforms are making it such that the small business are going to have a better environment to really be able to be integrated in the production process, because they will be facing more competition in the financial market with better interest rates. They will have access to cheaper energy. They will have access to cheaper telecom and internet costs or solutions for the manufacturing industry. So at the end of the day, the possibility of small and medium-sized business to integrate in value change after TPP are much greater than that with NAFTA.
Great, thank you. We're going to have time for three more questions. We need to take one over from this side of the room to even things up a little bit, and then we've got a couple right here.
Good morning. This is Cesar Parga from the Organization of American States. I first like to recognize Secretary Guajardo and his team for the leadership of Mexico as chair of the Inter-American Competitiveness Network, an effort leading all the competitiveness authorities and councils of the Americas. I think in this context, the collaboration between Mexico, the United States, the Department of Commerce, and Canada has been really increasing and projecting to the region. So my question is, how do you see this relationship between the NAFTA partners expanding the opportunities of trade and economic development around the Americas, in particular Latin America and the Caribbean?
Thank you very much.
Good morning, Secretary Guajardo. Manuel Suarez Mier, consultant here in Washington. All of what you said goes towards increased competitiveness in Mexico, which I think is the key, except for the commitments Mexico acquired in the recent global warming conference in Paris. Those have impacted negatively the competitiveness of the country, and the private sector is already complaining very loudly. What's your take on that?
Thank you. And then directly behind, I think there's a question. Thank you.
Thank you. Daniel Vasquez, Senior Director for North America at the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. Mr. Secretary, thank you very much for your words. The CEO dialogue, and in particular the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, is a strong supporter of the HLED. We look forward to getting the mechanism institutionalized. If you have any particular thoughts of how we can underpin those efforts, we'll be very happy to discuss them with you. And I have a question in terms of enforcement and TPP. As we know, this agreement encompasses a very large amount of countries spread in a very large geographical area. Do you have any particular views on how the three North American countries can work together in creating better enforcement mechanisms for the agreements that have been reached on the agreement? Could be on intellectual property, could be on enforcement of rule of origins, and so on and so forth. Thank you.
Well, first, Daniel, let me make a point that what you have just said about the HLID, an effort to institutionalize the instrument, has to be made. Now, the change of the Obama administration is going to happen in less than a year, and therefore that's why we have to work at a fast speed on how to make sure that the mechanism will prevail regardless of who is in the executive office, either in Mexico or the U.S. And the only possibility of doing that is if the private sector institutions that are involved, the U.S. Chamber of Commerce on the U.S. side and the Consejo Coordinador Empresarial on the Mexican side, will write a letter to President Obama and to President Peña, where they really state in that letter the need for this process to have a long-term commitment for the agenda on the U.S.-Mexico economic relationship, and to suggest the specific task forces that have to be created in this engagement in order to follow up specific targets and goals. For instance, we have just moved very fast in three border crossing points that are strategic. We did a tremendous advancement in pre-clearance, something that has been blocked in Mexico for the last 30 years, that U.S. custom officials should be on the Mexican soil and they have to carry their guns because of their responsibility in the U.S. And before that, has been historically prohibited for any U.S. official to carry a gun in Mexico. Now it was allowed, and now it will allow to have facilities in Mexico that will be able to do pre-clearance of merchandise without stopping in borders. And that's an incredible development. So these kind of things have to be spelled out clearly in this communication to President Obama and President Peña, suggesting what kind of task forces have to be implemented and how we should proceed ahead with this effort of the high-level economic dialogue, HLED. Now, in terms of the enforcement of some of the TPP regulations, I will say that you are right. I think that as North American partners, that has been my position with Ambassador Froman and my new colleague in Canada, that we should align our policy strategies together. Like in the case of the agreement with Europe that the U.S. is negotiating, we are going to modernize it, and Canada has just finished. We have to have a common grounds on how to define the best interest of North America in dealing with other regions in the world. And so in that case, it is definitely the point that if we are going to monitor that there is no triangulation in exports when you impose a tariff on subsidized merchandise, the three countries have to share mechanisms to guarantee that things obeyed by the rules. And that has to be part of the agenda. I fully agree with you. We are trying to do that in steel. We are having a meeting in Brussels on how to deal with China overcapacity in steel that is affecting the world steel industry today. And Manuel. Believe me, Manuel, if somebody has developed some I don't know if the word in English is sensible or sensitive response to the complaints of the private sector is myself, because the one that started this discussion are my colleagues from Monterey. I'm from Monterey, and so I listen to them every day. The complaint, and let me explain it to the public, because you know the subject, but everybody else doesn't know exactly what is the item. Mexico has committed to a new law of alternative sources of energy to fight against global warming that will impose, remind me, is by year 2025 that we should have a mix of traditional sources 75-25 or something like that. It's a mix where you have to have a target of low carbon emission energy, alternative energy, to be mixed with other sources of energy. And the complaint of the Mexican private sector is that Mexico is being more popish than the Pope. So we're going further than what the commitment of developed nations are. And in this case, when you look at carbon emissions of different countries, obviously China and the U.S. are at a higher level of pollution. But the commitment efforts are very, very, very radical, and there is a change in the curve, at least with the U.S., through time, that is very important. Mexico's emissions are very low, by definition, and our commitment is important, but the change in trend is not as severe as the one that is taking the U.S., which means that, yes, today we are not responsible for what is happening in global warming as much as other developed nations. But I'm trying to explain the private sector why we have to have that commitment. There are very few countries that will have the worst effects of global warming. And Mexico is in the top 10 countries that will be damaged severely by global warming. The fact that we are in the middle of two oceans makes us very vulnerable to these effects. And that has been shown recently with two hurricanes hitting us at the same time, coming from both sides of the sea. Therefore, if we, the ones that will result the most damage of global warming, don't show our commitment to this policy, then what can we expect from the big economies that are not following these efforts? So we have more to lose in this position. And once you come into the details of this energy mix, one of my points that is very important is today in Mexico, we are paying $1.9 per what is it, million, how do you measure gas? Million is
BTUs.
When other regions in the world are paying four times that amount. So we are already extremely competitive in the price of gas, which is going to balance, and at the same time, solar energy is becoming highly competitive in Mexico because of the endowment of Sunday light that we have in many regions. So I think that sometimes we get lost into the details because competitive sources are coming from different directions. And I do believe that at the end of the day, the balance of energy sources is going to give us an average price that still will be highly competitive in the world. Finally, just trying to understand the question. Your question was in terms of the relationship between antitrust actions, competitive actions,
The question, Secretary, was just as you articulated the common strategy to work with the United States and Canada to advance the relationships in Asia and in Europe. My question was how, as
to Latin America,
and the Caribbean, promoting competitiveness as a group and understanding that Mexico is leading this effort in the Americas.
Right? Yes. Well, definitely. Remember that we just finished Alianza Pacifico, but at the same time, Peru has an agreement with the U.S., Chile has an agreement with the U.S., and Colombia has an agreement with the U.S. So it will make a lot of sense if we work towards a process of really unifying our agreements in that relationship. But you are right. I mean, for us, the Latin American market has become extremely relevant, and we do believe that we should strengthen that positioning. In Central America, we have a free trade agreement that is with all the nations in the Central American region. The U.S. has some agreements with some of the nations in Central America. So it's highly relevant. Now, the big question about Latin America is what are we going to do with the big chunk of the economy, of the Latin American economy, that is represented by Brazil and Argentina? And my guess is that both of them are coming around very strongly towards trying to embrace free trade policies. And that's why we're engaged in widening our trade preference with Brazil, because it is an illusion trying to think of a strong integrated Latin America with leaving out Brazil and Argentina. And I believe that they are the right times to think positively with the future of that relationship, regardless of the very hard times that they are going through at this point.
Mr. Secretary, thank you very much. I'd like to thank you especially for your comments on climate change and energy transition in Mexico. When I lived there, the point that became clear to me was that when you live next to a hurricane factory, which is the Gulf of Mexico, you have to be especially concerned about violent weather. When you travel throughout Mexico and you see the conditions in places like Tabasco when there are violent weather events, and you see how deeply the people are affected. And then when you saw a few years ago what in fact happened to Monterrey, a city that we never thought would really be hit that hard by hurricanes, then you realize how important it is. And the other point about energy transition, renewable energies, and climate change is that Mexico's leading position amongst developing countries opens up the possibilities now in North America for meaningful talks on climate change and how North America can move out into the world and take a united position to talks beyond Paris. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a terrific conversation here. Please join me in thanking Secretary Ildefonso Guajardo.